All right, welcome everybody. Thanks for coming to Networking Hour. Today we're going to be talking about discipline entrepreneurship, the third step in the process, the third theme. How's your customer acquire your product? So far we've covered who is your customer and what can you do for your customer. And then moving on, we'll figure out how your customer is actually going to acquire your product. So very important step. We'll cover determining the customer's decision-making unit, mapping the process to acquire a paying customer, and then mapping the sales process to acquire a customer. So again, a little more detail about how you actually are going to get people to buy your product. And again, with all the discipline entrepreneurship steps, it's about getting specific about your business. The more specific you get, the more realistic your business is going to become, the more likely you are to succeed. So as we start going through all these steps and you answer these questions, who's your customer? What is your product going to be able to offer your customer? How is your customer going to acquire your product? All those things, you start to hammer out all the details in your business. And that's what's going to make it happen. All right, so I want to start off with a quote. This comes from Peter Thiel, who was one of the founders of PayPal and an early investor in Facebook. He's got this really important quote, good quote about the importance of customer acquisition channels. And so he says, it's very likely that one channel is optimal. Most businesses actually get zero distribution channels to work. Poor distribution, not product, is the number one cause of failure. You can get even a single distribution channel to work, it's a great business. You try for several, but you don't nail one, you're finished. What do you guys think of that? Yeah. So, I mean, you could have the greatest product in the world, but if you can't get it to your customer, you're not going to be able to build a business out of it. All right, so you really want to think about this process and what is it going to look like for your customer? And as you continue to get this process refined, your business is going to get more successful. The good thing is that your business is something you can continually refine this process and make it better and better. So you don't need to have it perfect day one. Just thinking through that process is always going to show you where you can improve and how you can make it better. All right, so the first step is determining the customer's decision-making unit. We talked a little bit about this when we talked about the customer, but mostly we've been focusing on the end user so far. When we talk about the decision-making unit, this is all the people that will be involved in the purchasing decision. Sometimes it's one person that plays all these roles. How's it going? But sometimes it's split out over multiple people. So three of the primary ones, you've got your primary economic buyer. This is the person with the money. You've got influencers and a champion. These are people who can drive or sway the decision-making process, but they may not have the money and they may not be the end user. And the end user is what we've been thinking about the whole time. That's the person that's actually going to use the product. So start thinking about this for your business of who's filling these roles and what does that look like. And you can even look beyond that. So you've got your economic buyer, your champion. You can have multiple influencers. You have somebody that just has veto power, so they could just say no for no reason or any reason at all, really. You get a compliance officer, anybody that's really going to be involved in the decision, you want to understand this. Because if you don't understand it, then you may be trying to sell a product and it may not make sense why it's not working or something like that. So you really want to understand how this process works. In some cases, it can be complicated. Multiple people may need to be sold. You know, just think if you're selling to a family, there may be a lot of people that you need to target and address in order to get a purchase made, especially if it's a higher dollar purchase. All right, so you want to carefully define each party and the nature of power in their acquisition process. So that primary economic buyer, the champion, end user, influencer, and potentially a saboteur. Have you got an idea of who a saboteur might be? What that means?
Husband, wife.
Okay. Somebody that doesn't have like a huge interest but can jump in and say like, no, this is not going to happen.
But is that like, so saboteur is different than competition, right? It's different than a different business.
Like, yeah, it's somebody that within
a negative
within
influence.
Your customer base that
yeah, they can just say no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And sabotage the whole sale.
Friends.
Yeah, or say Bart's going to get a new toy and then Lisa says, no way.
I want one too.
Yeah, I want one too, and that kind of ruins everything. So you want to be aware of that because there may be some ways that you can handle that situation. Here's an example from discipline entrepreneurship. This was a product that reduces power and cooling expenses for data centers. And so the primary customer here is a facilities manager. this is the person that pays the bills. He's got the problem of reducing energy expenses. And so he's going to be your customer, and he's the one with the money. But you can see there's a lot of other people involved because it's a business to business, so there's people that have stakes in a lot of different things. You've got an influencer in the green initiative, so somebody within the company that's pushing green activities would probably support this. You've got the data center manager that has the technical knowledge, but kind of just receives the budget. They're not the one that necessarily approves it. And then you've also got influencers of, you know, maybe the engineering, internal engineering within the company, and then other engineering firms. They may say that this is a good deal or this is a bad deal, things like that. But so you can see there's a lot of different pieces. You've got financing, purchasing. They basically can just say no. They can ask for a competitor's bid and slow down the process. But at the end of the day, they're not the end user, and you're not going to sell them. They're just, you're just going to hopefully not get squashed by them. Any questions on that? All right, here's another one. I think this product was something that would go on semi-trucks, and it would reduce liability for the semi-trucks. So the person that was interested in this was the operations manager. This is the one that, you know, would pay the price for any liability within the company. He wasn't a driver. And so the thing was, like, if this product went on drivers' cars and the drivers didn't like them, they could be sabotaged. They could either like it or they could not like it. There could be regulatory bodies that influence the process or prevent it from happening. And so you might have these other players here. So you really want to think about, what is this going to look like for your business? I mean, some of these get really complicated, particularly for medical, because you've got caregivers, and then you've also got the business side of it. And so mapping that out for the medical industry can be really complicated. All right, so as far as how to determine the discipline, yeah, I was talking to you.
Thank you very much.
Decision-making unit. You want to map out each person's role, understand their incentives. So what is, if you want to get at the root, is why somebody would be for or against something, kind of look at the incentives of their job. Like, say it's somebody that their goal is to push green initiatives, then they're probably going to support green initiatives. And so see what everybody's incentive is. You know, if it's the budget office, maybe they need to maintain a certain budget, so their incentive is that, regardless of anything else. They just don't want to spend money over a certain amount or something like that. So think about those incentives for each person. You want to ask the customer, what needs to be done to close the sale? So this is how you're going to figure this out. As you do your customer research, you start asking them, how does this business buy products? Or you ask your end user, how do you usually make purchasing decisions? What needs to be done to close a sale? Who's involved in the decision making? Who has the most influence? Whose budget does this affect? Any regulations to consider? And so you may see with some business to business that there's certain purchasing amounts that may need to go out for bid, or they may have higher approval levels. And you want to know what those are, especially if it's not a big deal to you, like $100 either way or something like that, but it can mean the difference between being able to just go in and sell this product as opposed to having you go out to bid for a bunch of competing bids. And so you only know that as you start to talk to your customers and you kind of understand how that process works. But ask this question first before you just blindly go in and try to sell, especially in a complicated organization. All right, so let's go through some examples. What does the decision-making unit look like for a toy company? Who's involved?
Purchase department?
Huh?
Purchase
no, for their customer.
Oh,
for their customer.
Yeah.
Kid.
Kid.
The kid. Mm-hmm.
What role do they play?
Champion.
End user.
That's an end user.
Could it be the same? Champion and end user?
Yeah, they could champion it. Who would be the economic buyer?
Parents.
Mom and dad.
Probably.
Yeah.
Or the parents or grandparents or uncles or aunts.
Yeah. Who would be a potential saboteur?
The same
as the buyer. Yeah. Whoever's not buying.
Sister.
It could also be the age of the child.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Siblings, any other family members.
Yeah. All right, now what about in a business to business sale? What might the decision making unit look like?
That's where you have a purchasing department and you have a CEO, CFO, management, engineering. It can be a lot of different things.
Mm-hmm. And what type of roles might they fulfill?
Let's say, for example, it's a marketing service.
Mm-hmm.
So then the sales division would be the saboteurs, maybe, potentially, or champions,
okay,
depending on what they're doing.
Yeah.
CFO would be the...
It's money.
Yeah, the purchaser.
Mm-hmm.
And
end user would be customer, right? Or what you
know. No, the end user would be the actual people doing the marketing.
Yeah, so you might have some dynamic where just some sales and marketing budget is shared or something like that. So
yeah, it depends on the company, right? How they're organized.
You see that in schools sometimes where there's like fixed amount of budget for new projects and things like that, and so it can be competitive between teachers trying to figure out where that budget gets spent.
I think it depends on the project.
Yeah.
How extensive experience in sales in the manufacturing industry. In every single project, there is a different champion, saboteur, and economic.
I guess it's more clear-cut with like siloed companies than companies that like have a lot more interaction with each other.
For say a specific project, would you see a similar decision-making unit at multiple companies?
Yes. Mostly the manufacturing. In this case, I used to provide machinery to the manufacturing industry in Mexico. Manufacturing engineers or electrical engineers or maybe product engineers are the decision makers. And purchasing departments are just the ones that bring to the table different suppliers and send the purchase orders, but they don't make the decision.
They're just stamping, basically.
They're stamping. Yeah. Sometimes if there is a repetitive product that they are acquiring, it's not necessary to have a decision maker every time. So that's the operation of the purchasing gem.
Yeah.
I think the most influential champion is plant managers or engineering managers. They are the champions, or even for the black belts, they are the
saboteurs.
They are who saboteurs as well. an influencer could be, for one project, could be positive and negative.
Yeah.
We call it white horse and black horse.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like a chess.
Yeah. And sometimes you have to figure out which side they're on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the key message there is that if you've got a similar project, a lot of these companies are going to be set up the same. And so you'll encounter similar decision-making units as you go to those other companies.
I would say there's a structure to it. Mm-hmm. In terms of, say, a toy company is going to see the same decision-making unit. There's going to be a classification.
Yeah.
And being in this industry of selling toys, your decision-making units will probably not vary by a significant amount. In manufacturing, the same thing applies because you're selling a product in a specific category. Now, when you start comparing across categories, it's like, wow, you know, in manufacturing, you wouldn't expect your parents, unless it's a family-owned business, to be the influencer. But in toy company sales and various things like that, it's all focused on family and less so unless you're selling toys that pose a significant difficulty in getting home where you have to rent a truck or it must be delivered by freight, where then that's something totally different. But without, I would say, huge variation, they're very category product specific.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you want to figure that out for your specific product, because if you know what the decision making unit is, you can craft a sales strategy that's pretty consistent, and you know what you're gonna have to face and overcome. Anybody want to talk about the decision making unit for their particular business if they've figured it out yet?
<It's pretty simple.
laughs> Well, I've two different types of ways we do sales. So we do wholesale and we do individual sales.
Mm-hmm.
So we're doing three types, I guess.
Yeah,
the other ones is, okay, so let's say individual sales, it would be generally our customer, which would be like the woman that's like you know, into natural health. So she would be end user and influencer. Sometimes economic buyer, I would say, like, you know, a good amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
Economic buyer could be her significant other or friend as well. Let's see, veto power could share that role with the economic buyer.
Mm-hmm.
And she would be compliance officer too, right?
Yeah.
Because she's the one judging whether she likes it or not.
I guess so.
Yeah, what, I mean...
Is that what you mean by compliance?
Yeah,
well, compliance officer is kind of like in a company.
Oh,
like if
okay.
you had some compliance officer that would prevent the purchase of something.
Oh, okay. So
I think the way they show it is a red light or green light
okay.
kind of thing. They're kind of like a saboteur.
Okay, so yeah.
Yeah.
The saboteur could be a friend or
yeah.
person
I,
she's with.
I think you got them too. I mean, the key ones are the economic buyer, the champion, and the end user.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, and then the influencers. Those may be present or not. But I think you're right that in some cases, one person is fulfilling all those
yeah.
roles.
We're kind of like the toy company.
Yeah.
The saboteur in your case, though, could also be a person who is just demanding of the end user's time to the point that they never get to use.
I could be a boss, I guess.
Oh,
yeah,
yes.
It's like an indirect saboteur.
Like not present in the actual thing.
Well, let's say that there's a lady who you decide, she's 20 years old or 25 years old, and she decides that she's going to come and she's going to do bath bombs twice a week, okay? So she goes and buys two bath bombs and is going to do these this week. She runs out of time because the kids are tugging at her, or
yeah.
her job or her guy or whatever is tugging at her, so she doesn't have time. So the next week she doesn't purchase from you because she doesn't have time to take the bath last week. So she still has those left over. So other people can sabotage her sales to like your sales with her.
Well, yeah.
Through other ways. You have to think of saboteur as like could be a whole different kind of.
It doesn't even have to be a person if you want to think like that, right? It can just be
just her job.
Yeah.
So I think that if you understand that, maybe is there some way to overcome it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, these are all just frameworks.
Yeah. What about wholesalers?
Wholesalers, so they actually are all of the above, except for the end user. They're not the end user. So they would be, you know, they make all the, usually it's just one person you deal with, because
yeah.
we deal with smaller businesses.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, they're the buyer, they're the influencer. Well, I would be, I guess, the influencer, right? Since I'm the one.
And their boss.
Yeah, and their boss.
Okay.
Veto power. Boss again, if there's a boss,
mm-hmm.
An end user would be whoever.
I guess the end user would be the influencer.
Because
if they're buying,
situation.
Yeah.
Well, I guess you think of the purpose of why they're buying it. So
yeah,
a wholesaler is
buying
it to sell. So you can think of them as an end user.
Either way.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's good. Any other examples? Alright, so summary of the chapter, you want to understand all members of the decision-making unit to address challenges in the sales process, especially the primary economic buyer and the champion. The decision-making unit can help make sense of delays, obstacles, and improve your sales strategy. So as you start to understand how this works, you may start to see, oh, that's why that's not happening as fast as it should be, it's because it's stuck with this particular person. Or there may be some obstacle that you would be unaware of if you didn't understand what that whole decision-making unit looks like. And some of these people you may not be able to deal with directly. Like I guess in the case of the wholesalers, you're talking to a rep, but they're probably talking with their boss and you may not have a chance to interface with them, but they could play a role in the decision. So you want to be aware, is there something that you could do to make that decision easier for them or whatever it is? Yeah, it may be sharing sales projections or something like that would help the supervisor make that decision.
Oh, okay. How can it benefit them?
Exactly, yeah. Thinking about their needs and, you know, help that rep make the case to purchase this particular thing.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Some more questions. Any examples of decision-making units that you've been a part of?
Indecision units.
Which is saboteurs. A bunch of people would be
yeah.
a problem.
I I mean, Christmas, it's like, I'm like the toy one that's like us all the time.
Yeah.
We have a huge family.
Yeah. So we like.
Pretty big decision.
Yeah. And between my husband and myself, we just like switch off, like, oh, well, do you think this is a good reason? And what? Like, I honestly make him list why I should spend thousands of dollars on Christmas because I think it's crazy. So, like, we have to have these conversations all the time. So I would say, yeah, he would be the influencer, an economic buyer, and I would be the veto.
I guess.
Yeah, the veto or saboteur. End users would be what we're talking about.
Yeah, very good. Yeah.
So we moved from California to New Mexico. Huge decisions.
Mm.
Purchasing a house. Which one? There's a million of them.
Yeah.
How much? We don't know. Where do we want to be? We had no idea. There was no reason for us to purchase the house we purchased other than the layout of the house, and we thought it had potential for economic growth. And at the time, it made sense. Looking back, wish I never would have done that. So all of those decisions, I mean, every single one of them was process of decision-making units, of whose roles they can put, you know, based on what and the conversations. It was a real process. It's not just like a, oh, hey, I think I'll just go do this.
Yeah.
Let's go get a gallon of milk today.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
Yeah, big decisions like houses, I mean, there's a lot to it.
But even for B2B companies, I think there is an emotional part for the buying process. Even if they are professionals, professional purchasing agents, if they feel that you offer, they trust in you,
mm-hmm.
You are your, they are friends of you, even if they are being paid for that. There is a big decision making with emotions every time, even for B2B sales.
If they feel that they can work with you.
Yes.
Yeah,
so like a likability? Likability kind of thing?
Oh, yeah, totally.
Oh, absolutely.
Charm, charisma. Like, if they think, like, wow, I can really work with that guy, and, like, the products are, like, here and here.
Yeah.
And like, yeah, but I can work with this guy, even though he's just here. They'll choose this guy over this guy.
But in order to achieve that, you need to understand very well what is the problem of your customer. So that's makes the relationship happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. They're not just going to buy from a friend that's, like, a way worse product or something like that.
Not
you know, I mean, it could be a differentiator, but just think of the difference between, like, a cold call and, like, if you already have a relationship with somebody, you just call them up and you tell them something, they trust you right away, and it's a lot simpler. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so building that relationship is definitely important. And we talk about it sometimes, like, businesses will buy either to save money, make money, or reduce risk.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And you could look at that basically as, if there's some trust there, then there's a reduction of risk.
I have a question.
Sure.
What's the difference between like a champion and an influencer? Because I feel like for like Beck's Coffee, like I really love Beck's. So like if my friends and I want to go out to coffee, I always suggest that place first. So I feel like that would be a champion role. But is that also an influencer, or like what's the difference?
The champion is the one that's going to like, that really wants this to happen.
So right? We really want to go there. We really want to, okay.
Exactly. And they're kind of going to see it through. An influencer may just offer opinions.
Okay.
And be like, I don't really like that place. Or that place is good.
Okay, but it's not necessarily as passionate or something, is it?
Exactly, yeah. So sometimes on like a big purchase that involves a lot of people, it may take one person that's like, we have to do this to help sell everybody else. And if you have a good champion, they can go around and sell the economic buyer and these other people and really make the transaction happen.
Sometimes the champion is his job. I mean, they are being paid for improvements in the company. Sometimes the influencer is just an influencer. I mean, if he has a bad reputation, a bad experience with some company, could be a negative influencer for that decision.
Okay.
So, the champion is the one who is incentivized to provide that solution.
Yeah.
Okay.
Question. Mm-hmm. So can the champion be considered, can you consider a salesperson part of the DMU or a champion?
Well, I think the way you usually want to think about this is your company and your sales arm are interacting with the decision making unit. I mean, I guess you could you definitely have an influence.
Because a lot of times, yeah, like that salesperson is.
Yeah.
Especially if they built a really good relationship, they become a like a really big influence.
Yeah, I could see that. Typically, it's not listed. Maybe that's just because it's implied, I guess. The salesperson is always trying to influence and champion a sale.
See, in that way, in this way, as I
that's
see
the right way to think about it.
The champion is the person that you want to develop that relationship because they'll open the door for that company for you.
I see. Yeah, so if you can find customers that are champions, you give them free product, you do all kinds of stuff to keep them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's another word for it. Anybody heard of the concept of a maven?
Oh, yeah, we talked about it last week, I
think. Yeah, where somebody, they just love your product so much that they're going to go tell all their friends about it. Mm-hmm. I guess you'd probably be a maven for Bex.
For Bex, yeah.
So, but just think of those products that you're super passionate about, and then every chance you get, you're going to tell other people. And so, I mean, it may be a strategy as you're starting out, is like try to satisfy these customers so much that they're just like, this is the best ever. And they're going to tell all their friends about it because that can be a valuable marketing tool. You get a lot of people that are really passionate about it, that kind of spurs, you know, viral marketing and all that type of stuff. Mm-hmm. Really important for word of mouth. All right. Any other questions on DMU? Good. All right. Next step, mapping the customer acquisition process. So this is where you really want to see this whole process through. What does it look like? And once you see what it looks like, you can identify opportunities to improve it. So, how will customers buy your product? Understand the buying process, understand the decision-making process. So anybody think their business will go like this? Once they see my product, they're going to have it. Sales will go immediately to the moon. Anybody think that's going to happen?
God, if only. I know.
Yeah. We all wish that.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, there's usually a lot more to it. Companies have a process and buying things, and it takes a while, and you really want to figure out what that's actually going to look like, because it's very unlikely that it'll just take off. A lot of those, what do they talk about? Overnight successes were years in the making, you know, kind of thing. All right, product sales cycle. So if it's B2B, there may be a specific way they want to buy products. I know in schools, that's a big deal where they, you know, get budgets certain times a year and they spend it. Understand how long that decision-making process is going to take. Understand that impact on your cost and your sales expenses. If you're going to have a bunch of salespeople doing sales, and these sales take a long time, you're paying for those salespeople that whole time.
Could be paid off for the business.
It could be, yeah. So you want to see what that's going to look like so you can make some adequate projections about cash flow.
I have a really nice story. example. In the acquisition process, every time that a purchasing or champion or end user is approaching to the end of the fiscal year, is the best time to sell products in a B2B company, I mean, for an enterprise, because they need to spend all the budget to get the budget. That's amazing. I mean,
yeah.
If you have been working with that project, you will see the decision coming very, very near to
to sell, like, corporate retreats and things like that, or mm-hmm. trainings, where you get to the end of the year and you've got some extra budget, and this would be a value add, and yeah, you're right, if they don't spend the budget, maybe they'll lose it next year.
Love that.
Mm-hmm. So it's important for me, like, to know the fiscal year time frame versus the regular year time frame, and which of my customers are on which end of that, because some of them will be on the regular year and some of them will be on the fiscal year, and that's important stuff for me.
Yeah, and as you talk to customers, how do their budgets work? Do they get allocated a budget for a month or for a year? And is it typically all spent at the beginning of the year, or is there usually some left over at the end? Or is it on a more ad hoc basis or something like that? There's another example, just understanding kind of how those, like a business or somebody operates can help you out. Like for venture capital funds, they typically operate for about 10 years, and they'll spend the first couple of years being picky, and then they get to years like 3 to 5, and they basically need to spend all the money that they've raised to invest in order to get returns by year 10.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's kind of a sweet spot about when you ask a venture capitalist for money. If they've got a fund and it's year 7, they probably have all their money invested, and they're not going to invest in you. Whereas it's, you know, if it's too early, then they're not feeling that push, like, I need to make this investment now, so they might be a little more patient. And so there's kind of a sweet spot there. And so you may find some similar things with your customers, where there's just a time that it's the right time for them to be buying your product. All right, identify hidden hurdles, any budgetary stuff, regulatory, any compliance issues that you're gonna have to deal with. And understand what those are so you can figure out how to overcome them. All right, when you talk about customer decision-making process, this is a good tool to just have in mind. In order for somebody to make a decision to purchase, they typically don't just purchase something. They, number one, need to have awareness of it, of the product and the problem. Number two, they need to start to have some type of interest to look into it a little more. After that, they need to go through a consideration phase where they're like, I'm interested, now I'm gonna start considering this and maybe shopping against other alternatives. And only from there can they get to this purchase phase. Now, customers can go through this very fast, especially if it's a low budget item. But it may be more complicated for bigger sales, and you may really need to work people through these processes. And you wanna see what, you know, what is your customer going through? Maybe they're not getting aware of your product, and so that doesn't even start the funnel. Or maybe they're not being transitioned through these phases appropriately. You know, just think of, like, maybe there's a, think of a website that's just like, here's this brand new product, and that's all there is to it. There's not enough information to generate interest. There's not enough information to generate, you know, to actually consider it. And maybe there's not even a good way to purchase it, kind of thing. So think about all those steps. They all need to be in place in order to get somebody all the way to purchase. All right, another tool is the timeline. A way to use this is to talk to either existing customers or customers of products and try to understand what they went through in order to buy that product. And so you start just with this first thought and then a blank line, and you start to fill it in. Try to figure out what got them passively looking. Like, what was that first thought? Maybe I need some new product or something like that. Kind of passively looking, was there some event then that triggered that actively looking, and then another event that moved them to deciding, and then where they actually bought and consumed and all that stuff. And if you understand these things, then you can start to add things to your product to maybe overcome some of the objections that are found along the way, or try to trigger some of those events that move people through the process. There's an example of this using the jobs to be done. Guy was doing real estate sales. So he's a real estate developer, and he was trying to figure out how to sell all these homes that he developed. And so what he did is he talked to people that had just bought homes. And so he went through and, like, what were all the steps that got them through to actually purchasing the home? What he found out was that it wasn't money. It wasn't you know, that they didn't want a new house. They knew they wanted a new house and they had the budget to do it. But the big concern, the obstacle, was that they didn't know what they were gonna do with their stuff when they moved. Like, they just didn't want to go through that. And so then what they started offering was storage to go along with new home move-ins. And so that overcame that objection, they're able to move people through the sales process a lot quicker. It's a little cheap add-on, but it's all based on understanding how that worked. And what their pain points are. All right, so how to map out the process. How will potential customers turn into real customers? The key components, how are they gonna determine the need for your product? How are they gonna become aware of your product? How will they acquire it, install, utilize it, and then how will they actually pay for it? You wanna make that as smooth as possible. Map it out for what it looks like now, and then see if there's opportunities to improve it. We'll talk about this the week after spring break. We'll do a talk on traction. This is a book on how to get customers, 19 channels for how to get customers. And it's a great book. These guys did a lot of research to figure out that there's basically these 19 ways people get customers. And they've got a process for figuring out which channel will be best for you. And so we'll go into a lot more detail on that in 2 weeks. An important thing to think about with this customer acquisition strategy is it's an opportunity for you to differentiate. You think of differentiation, innovation, you classically just think of value creation, some new product or service innovation. But there's ways to differentiate basically just with the business model. Or maybe there's a unique way to promote your business. And those type of things can be really powerful. So you remember that quote with Peter Thiel about not getting any distribution channels to work. Even if it's a great product, if you can figure out a unique way of getting customers, you can differentiate over those other ones that haven't figured out that way to get customers. And so when you think about innovation, these are opportunities for you to innovate. And innovating on a business model or value promotion is typically a lot cheaper than creating some brand new fancy product or service. All right, so as you map this out, put yourself in the customer's shoes. You want to be aware of this leaky bucket. Where are people falling out of the process and not converting into paying customers? If you can see where they're falling out, then you can maybe do some things to help more people get in that funnel. Think of it as a funnel. People come in the top and then out the bottom to paying customers. Where are they getting out? Is there some budgeting or purchasing authorization that's hanging things up? That whole process from initial contact to paying customer. And you want to start with that full lifecycle use case that we talked about, I think last week.
Could you please repeat the leaky bucket analogy?
So say you're trying to catch fish or something like that, okay. Whatever. You've got all these leads of people, okay. You could sell to, and your business is trying to convert them to paying customers. Yeah. So is there a leak? Are people falling out?
Okay.
And is there something you can do about it? So you're able to enhance your conversion rates and get more sales for the same number of leads. Okay. And especially, you know, if you're paying for leads through like search advertising or something like that, being able to convert more effectively reduces your cost to customer acquisition pretty significantly.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, a summary on this, understand and optimize, refine your customer acquisition process. First by mapping out where it is now, and then trying to improve it from there. What will allow you to move to more easily acquire customers, move through the process more easily? If you have something that's a deal breaker, you really wanna know that early. And so as you start to investigate and see how this works, is there something that's just gonna prevent people from buying your product? And this is that first step to calculating cost of customer acquisition, which we'll talk about later steps, and that's a really important part of your business model. All right, any questions on customer acquisition?
You recommend we just choose one channel.
Right? One customer?
One channel, like one method of acquiring customers.
We'll talk about it in traction, but typically what you'll do is they go through this bullseye process where you see, like, how could you use each of those 19 channels? Like, just take a guess. Like, how would you use viral marketing for your business?
Viral marketing.
Whatever it is. Go through all 19 of them and just brainstorm ideas. Then what you'll do is you put them into buckets. Is like, these are probably the most practical for us. And then you go test two or three on a small scale. And once you find out one that's really effective, then you put your resources into it.
Into that one. Okay.
And you'll use that until that one doesn't work anymore, and then you repeat the process.
As opposed to like a shotgun approach, like trying to do everything else.
Because you want a way to test what's going to be the most effective.
Yeah. Okay.
Like what Alexis did with the emails, and he realized that didn't work.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so test it in attraction channels, and is that going to work, or is it not? But test it on a small scale so it doesn't cost too much.
Yeah.
And then once you start to see one is really rising up, as this is the way to get people in the funnel, okay. Then you start putting more resources in. Because typically one channel is going to be better than another. And if you're going to commit significant resources, you want to put them in the best one. And it's okay to test multiple at first. And you can definitely do multiple at the same time, but you're probably going to want to eventually allocate your resources to the most lucrative. Any other questions? All right. Any examples of customer acquisition processes that have worked on you? Anything that caused you to buy a product? Think about how maybe you went from awareness to interest to consideration to purchase.
When I used to do hearing, the way that the vendors sold to us, the food vendors were, like, they would bring us of samples of
things. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Or they would offer to cook for us for one day. And so that helped us like make our decision. And even if they were more expensive, sometimes we would get the ones that gave us the most service.
Yeah.
Offered to train our cooks, things like that.
Yeah, so that's all different ways of providing value.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great example.
I have a question. I have an example.
Okay.
And that is regarding my espresso machine.
Oh, okay.
So when I decide to buy a new espresso machine is because the last one that I have, it was under the level that I want to do with espresso, quality espresso, to get this a quality espresso. So it was a commercial grade that I buy in Target. And then next I want to move to a very professional, very commercial grade, but for home use. So the beginning I became aware because I was following different baristas and baristas competitions around the world. And I figured out what are the brands, the Italian brands of the machines. I conduct a research. Honestly, I did a research.
You like talking.
I went to the benefits matrix.
You're a serious champion.
Yeah. But when I came up with my final decision, the most important thing was the decision, the budget approval of my wife. You know? Because I choose one of the most expensive machines, that was La Marzocco, but I have a second option that is the one that I bought. So my wife approved the cheaper one. But yeah, it was a very nice case to share with you because I went through all the stages, mm-hmm. but the final decision was made by my wife. Yeah.
So the wife is the economic buyer. He's the end user and champ.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, I did all the work.
Yeah, that's a good example.
Yeah.
So in his example, though, the business is not technically selling to him. He was doing the work of like the.
So I
see it that way. I see the business that they have to give him the information.
They're putting out the info.
He has to be able to find the product, find the sales brochure or whatever at website or whatever they've got.
They have to attend the
whole bunch of
stuff
that
I become aware because they're using. Very specific brands during the competition.
Yeah.
So I went through those websites.
The business that makes
yes.
the person that makes that machine is what I'm saying was not the person promoting to you. They may have promoted. They may have done the work earlier on with that other person.
It doesn't matter.
So the important thing to think about too is, was it a marketing strategy for them to become the name
in those barista competition?
In the barista competition, because that. Because that's what we're talking about here is really just testing all the marketing options and ways that you can market, and then finding that thing of, wow, we have a lot of customers that are seeing these people using these types of machines, so we should try to sponsor the event so we could get our name on the event itself.
Yeah.
Okay.
That would be how they're acquiring you on the marketing sense.
But even if he would have had all that information, if he would have gone looking for that product and they didn't have a website or information that he needed to have to support his influencing the decision part of it, then they would have fallen down on their job and then he would have gone with something else. If he couldn't find that brand, he would have had three other brands to look at and would have probably gotten information that he wanted from the other ones and then gone, I'll just
take that Enzo Ferrari approach of marketing where your end goal is to fund some other project, but you sell high-end hypercars just to fund that product. Like Enzo Ferrari, when he started out, he just wanted to sell cars so he could do racing. He didn't necessarily care about the end consumers, but because those cars were so high quality and so amazing, he was like, oh, yeah, whatever, but he's like, we're a racing team, this is what we do. And that's what he wanted to go, but it, inherently that brand was already steps above everybody else because it was almost like a reverse product of he wants to fund professional racing cars. In order to do that, he has to sell cars that are at least somewhat equivalent so that if any technology he may use in racing, it could either filter back, but then again, it's also cheaper that if he could just use racing parts on street legal cars, it makes it easier for him to sell, even though it might be questionable. But and like you're saying with the coffee brand, it could be just the brand itself, and you know the customers are just aware that the brand sells itself, not necessarily that they're adding products. Like, look at the amount of people who buy Apple products and tout to other Apple people. Most of the time, and it's obviously generalization, but most of the time, people who buy Apple products really don't know what's in them or the limitations of those products. Mm-hmm. They're buying the brand.
The brand, yes.
And just, that's what they're buying. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's, how else do we get a $1,000 iPhone X? Which, you look at it and you kind of spend 5 minutes thinking about it, you're like, that thing is $1,000, and functionality-wise, you could probably go through 15 phones that would outlast that one. They may break a lot more often, but in the end, you're buying some really, you're essentially buying somebody else's marketing or somebody else's word of mouth. You're not really buying the product. It's, you know, their experience, it's what they're selling is.
I mean, for Apple, you're buying into an ecosystem. You're not really, like, they don't just sell, like,
right, once you're in that ecosystem, it's insanely hard to get out.
And that's
in by intent. That's by design. Once we have you.
Yeah.
And it becomes you're no longer, it's the illusion of choice once you're an Apple. You think you have these other choices, but you really don't. You're still stuck in this Apple ecosystem because then you have to go buy hardware or software that's specifically designed for Apple. All of your choices, though, seem like choices, you're still stuck in Apple products.
Mm-hmm. I think the Ferrari and the coffee examples are really good because it's about how your customer's making their decisions. Mm-hmm. Like the with the Ferrari example, somebody's buying a super high-end sports car, they're gonna look at what is the fastest car racing. You go, oh, that's probably the best brand. Or, you know, with coffee, you'll look at which ones are doing the best in these competitions, mm-hmm. and then start to equate that as the best brand. So I think it's probably like a targeted marketing strategy of product placement, but then you also need to have all the other pieces there to make sure that it's not a leaky bucket and people don't fall out along the process of like, okay, I'm interested in this brand, now how do I consider the process and then actually purchase? And so if all that wasn't in place, then you couldn't have made it all the way through and actually purchased that one. So what it's all about, thinking about how your customer does make that decision. What are those I guess influencers for them.
Kramer, in this case, the coffee with that website would be an influence, where he was looking at the information.
Usually you think of the decision-making unit as people fulfilling roles, and then on the customer side too. So the website, I guess, definitely played a role, but it's kind of like that salesperson. Of course, it's going to play a role. You're trying to influence somebody to buy. The important part is it's there and it does help them get through that customer decision-making process.
In my case, I choose different models, and I was asking some of my friends, what of those machine looks better? I know what is the performance, all the technical details, I know it. I know what is better, but my budget was very limited, and I was trying to self-accomplished. It was, oh, this looks very nice. So, yeah, my friends were part of the decision as influencers.
Your friends and
my family, yes.
Yeah.
Well, the biggest influencer were the championship. I saw different brands over there, and I know that if they were advertising over there,
mm-hmm.
it's because they are top of the notch.
So top, did you just one from the website or your friends recommended? Which one did you use?
Just,
oh, which one did you buy?
We wanna
something that your friend recommended you, or something that you
No, saw no, no. I did all the job, but at the end, I came up with three options. Two options, by the way. All meets my requirements, but I have to ask for that budget approval. You know,
economic buyer.
Yeah.
So that's like the genius part of Amazon. It does all of that for you, or it gives you the illusion that it's doing all that for you. You could check few boxes and compare them, and they suggest comparisons.
I think that's a great example because it helps customers go all the way from awareness to interest, consideration, purchase. Yeah, and imagine how hard Amazon would be to use if you didn't have like the reviews or a good way to really do that consideration piece. Mm-hmm. And so that was really, you know, like a key piece in making making it easy for customers to make a decision. Because if they don't have that information, they can't make a decision, and they fall out of the process. They just won't buy.
I think another thing about Amazon that they were just trying to make this process as quick as possible is with those buttons that they patented, where you could put them around your home,
and
you ran out of toilet paper and you press a button and it sends automatically to your house.
That's crazy.
So it's taking all that process of trying to decide which type of toilet paper.
Easy button.
Well, yeah, exactly. All it is I hit this button, $7 goes from my bank account, and in a week I'll have toilet paper, or 3 days. Yeah, more like 3 days.
And the way you come up with that innovation is by looking at how are the customers interacting with the site and what can we do to make it easier.
Exactly.
Yeah. Definitely. All right, so last step, mapping the sales process to acquire a customer. So this is understanding the details of customer acquisition will make clear the drivers of the costs in the sales process. So then you can start to figure out how to make the sales process shorter and then more cost effective. Is really the goal here. You want to be able to answer the following questions. How does the customer learn about, learn they have a problem? How does the customer learn about your solution? What does the customer need to know to decide how to purchase your product? How do you get this information to them? How do you make the sale? And then how do you collect the money? And so all those steps, you want to figure out what you're doing there and then how much does that cost you to get somebody through that. Some overlooked costs in customer acquisition are these hidden sales and marketing costs. So printing brochures, creation of websites, salaries of salespeople. Especially if they're getting paid on like an hourly basis as opposed to commission, that can be very expensive if they're not converting sales. Or if sales take a long time to close. Varied lengths of sales cycles, that can have a big impact. And then this percent of potential customers that engage but don't purchase the product because they're taking up time and resources but they're not closing. So effectively all the costs on these people that did a purchase are then need to be allocated over the people that actually did. All right, and then any changes to the DMU that can impact your ability to sell the customer, those can be pretty impactful. All right, so just to consider different time frames. This is kind of a classic way to look at, you know, how your sales strategy might work. At first, it might be all about demand creation. You're gonna be doing direct sales and then interacting with customers to demonstrate your value proposition and kind of understand how to sell your product. Make the market aware of the product, gather feedback from customers for product improvements. And direct sales is expensive because you know, you've got people directly interacting. What you wanna try to do is eventually figure out how you can automate some of those pieces and then make this more straightforward. So in the short term, direct sales may be the best way to start. Over the medium term, you might shift towards the order fulfillment. So your direct sales will shift to the customers with the highest lifetime value, the customers that are gonna buy the most, and then focus on order fulfillment instead of demand creation. You can start using value-added resellers that are selling for your company or distributors, because this might reduce your cost of customer acquisition. You're not having to do all of it yourself anymore, especially once you've been able to prove that the product can sell and it makes sense to carry it in other stores or whatever that is. And then in the long term, more like client management. So the sales is going to focus on fulfilling our orders because the demand has been generated, the awareness is out there, and then you start to shift to more indirect marketing such as internet and telemarketing. So I mean, think of all the companies that are able to get you to pay for something without actually having a person interact with you. I mean, if it's all through a website, once that system is designed, that's really low cost. And so usually it starts with you know, people obviously to figure out how the sale needs to be made, but once you understand what that looks like, then it can start to go on a website and you can give customers all the information they need to get through that decision-making process. All right, any questions on that? So this would be kind of a map. At first, maybe 100% direct sales. Medium term, you do 50% direct sales. And then long term, you're shifting out to maybe only 25% direct sales with your biggest potential buyers. And then moving the sales to other value-added resellers and things like that. All right, can you guys think of any examples of businesses that have changed their sales strategy over time? maybe they started out doing direct sales and then changed?
Netflix.
Walmart.
Okay.
The stores, and now they have like all the stuff online, and then now you can pick it up at the store, and you can do site to store and all that. It's changed a lot.
That's a good example.
10 years.
And all to really save time. And I heard they're opening up in like 100 cities to actually do same day delivery and those type of things. So yeah, that's a good example. Any others?
Alibaba.
How they start?
They were doing just marketing to wholesalers on the internet.
Oh yeah.
And then now they do. I mean,
just the
they do all kinds of stuff. Now they do like Taobao, or not Taobao. They do. They do Taobao, and they do like they have some stores now. Like they have actual grocery stores, and you can buy all your stuff on the phone, and then it goes through like conveyors.
Oh no way!
And then like it just like. Your stuff arrived at checkout.
Oh wow!
And like bagged and stuff, and then you just pay with your phone too, and then take off.
I have
cool.
A very classic example. Sears.
Okay.
They started with a catalog.
Yeah, that's true.
And they opened big stores with a lot of demos, and so they started in a railroad catalog in every single station.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it made sense at the time because. You know, there's hard to put a store everywhere. Transportation was more of an issue at that time.
Mm-hmm.
The mail order was pretty revolutionary, but then after that,
it was a constant reminder. Once you got that catalog, I think it was massive enough that it sat there.
Yeah.
And it was younger people don't know what a phone book is, and those of us that do, there would be advertising in it, and then the phone book's essentially been just. I wouldn't say that its business changed as much as it's been kind of.
Yeah.
Sideline, but yeah, I think the Sears one is great
because
it went from let's show you pictures, prices, either just everything we have, and you just peruse it at your leisure, which is a crude version of the internet, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So have a look and come on in when you decide.
Yeah.
Or send us some, you know, they did purchase it through catalog, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was the it was all check based. I don't know.
Yeah, you could call them up and everything.
Oh, that's what they put it, so.
I think you actually buy houses out of there.
They would deliver it to your house too if it was a big enough item.
Yeah.
They're like Sears houses where they send all the parts. And
really?
one that's up and coming, and I follow their stuff a lot is Magnolia Homes. So they started out just like being flippers, house flippers, and then they got a show, HGTV.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's HGTV. And then now they sell their stuff in Target. They have a magazine.
Mm.
They have, they do like bed and breakfasts. So like they completely changed their sales strategy. Like it's, they're just a corporation now.
Yeah, that's a really good example.
Yeah,
where over time,
oh, yeah.
You sell your products completely differently. Mm-hmm. Completely different services. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, so if you get nothing else, understand your customer's decision-making process to make your product or service the most compelling choice. Innovation and customer acquisition can be powerful and profitable, and don't use the leaky bucket. All right, so next, we're not going to meet next week because we've got a spring break. But when you guys get back, we'll talk about the book traction and how you get customers. And that should be a really good talk. So we'll see you then. I guess a couple announcements. Aggie Startup Club. They've got meetings
next Wednesday.
Spring break? Or the Wednesday after?
Wednesday after spring break.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool. And I guess my flyer disappeared for Aggie I-Corp. But if you do have a STEM-based business, Aggie I-Corp applications are open through the 18th. And so go to icorp.nmsu.edu and submit your application. It'd be a great program to get you into.
Okay.
All right. Well, thanks for coming. And we'll see you next time.
So how's the coffee?
So how's the espresso?